the session Engendering Southeast Asia, because I feel when I'm teaching history, a lot of the time it tends to be sort of dominated by boring political things and economic things. And so I like to gender Southeast Asia, because unlike increasingly more fluid constructs of gender in the West, Southeast Asia is one of the places in the world where you can have up to 5 different genders going on at once. So, this is still very, very much sort of going to be on women, because women are usually the people who are most affected by things like gender-based violence and discrimination. So we will be also delving into different kinds of gender constructs in Southeast Asia though. So, on my opening screen, as you can see, are lots of different Southeast Asian women. We have some women from Toraja over here. We have some women in Malaysia there. We have women in Cambodia threshing rice. We have a young lady in Bangkok here who works as a hostess. And we have the foundation, or the founder of Phnom Penh, according to popular legend, a lady called Dam Pen. Pen being, so Phnom means hill, Pen is Lady Pen's name, so it's the Hill of Pen, or Pen's Hill. It's actually the capital of Cambodia. And she has a small shrine set up on top of Wat Phnom, the place in Cambodia where she is said to have found 4 statues as the floodwaters receded, 3 of Buddha and 1 of Vishnu. And she set up these statues on this hill, and a temple came to be built there, which is still a working Wat even today. Lady Pen here looks quite Vietnamese in facial characteristics, but she was most definitely Khmer. It's probably a reflection of the ceramics trade going on between Vietnam and Cambodia in the 1990s. Okay, so when I teach about gender in Southeast Asia, I'm never really sure how many of my students are aware of the gendered meanings that clothes have. So I like to start off with this illustration from a Cambodian book that was published in the early 1980s, basically to talk about what Cambodians should be wearing for different events in their lives. And so, as you can see, these are quite formal outfits. And then they all sort of are coding some kind of gender at us as we look at them. But these kind of things happen differently from place to place. And so one of the things I like to do with my students is I'll give them a little quiz in the first session. So which are gender statements and which are statements about sex? So women give birth to babies, men do not. It's biological, so it's sex. Little girls are gentle, boys are tough. It's amazing how many people get that one wrong.
Yeah.
Amongst Indian agricultural workers, women are paid less than men. Amazing how many people get that one wrong as well. I often have people say, yeah, but the men are stronger, so they will do more work. Yeah, that's the problem, right? Women can breastfeed babies, men can bottle feed babies. Sex. Most construction workers in America are men. According to United Nations statistics, women do 67% of the world's work, yet their earnings for it amount to only 10% of the world's income. Gender. So, last time I taught this class, number 4 sort of got quite heated. People really felt that should be a gender one, because, you know, men could theoretically breastfeed babies if they took the right hormones. According to my students. Okay. So, going back to clothing for a second, clothing's often gendered and has different meanings from place to place. In Australia, where I come from, if you see a person with a piece of cloth around their waist, you're going to assume it's a woman, because that is a characteristic of female gender. But in Scotland, both men and women wear pieces of cloth around their waists because the wearing of kilts is not gender specific. This works in my class back in Illinois, because we have a lot of people of Scottish descent there. They're like, oh right, yes, a kilt is a skirt. Okay, so gender differences change over time, obviously, and they're reflected in the roles, responsibilities, opportunities, access to resources, needs, constraints, perceptions, and views held by all people, whether they be male, female, transgender, or between genders. Okay, so by the end of the 1980s, people realized that after the decade of women of the 1970s, during which initiatives like women in development were used, And this really came about because in the 1970s, women's organizations sought to empower women in less developed countries like Southeast Asia by initiating a movement called Women in Development, or WID. It called for special initiatives for women, including microfinance schemes that were available only for women, a quota of women to be included in elections, and so on. But by the end of the 1980s, it was evident that these initiatives were not changing ingrained perceptions about gender roles and stereotypes that had negative consequences for women. This came about because men had not been involved in the initiatives. So it became clear that targeting only women in order to improve their situations was not going to work. Both men and women had to be involved in the process. So the way we talk about this now is gender and development. So there's a change, a shift from women to gender. Okay, many of the issues and problems in Southeast Asia that are associated with gender have to do with new forms of globalizing forces that have come about because of problems in the global economic process that continues to duplicate inequality in of wealth and income between countries and between people in the same country as well. Largely a legacy of colonialism, which I spoke about in the previous talk. So rural poor women in Southeast Asia have been impacted by processes of globalization in a number of ways. So the land taken to develop means that environmental resources are destroyed. So women have to find new ways of supporting themselves and their families. Women having to find new ways to survive means disrupting traditional roles that in which men and women may have had different but equally appreciated things to do. Because women have to go further away from the home and do different things to support their families, they may be seen by communities as stepping beyond what is an acceptable boundary in terms of what women should and should not do. And this may lead to an increased intolerance of female autonomy and therefore violence against women in retaliation. Poor rural women who can no longer work in agriculture as land gets developed have to find other occupations, which have been called women-specific or female-prone. They usually involve low pay, they're labor-intensive, and you don't need many skills in order to do it, and a very low level of technological awareness. Globalization has also encouraged the growth of labor migration between the countries of Southeast Asia. And with this, the emergence and increased importance of labor exporting and labor importing countries. So for example, in Thailand, they import poor people from Cambodia a great deal because they will work for less money than a Thai will work with the same job. Often now Thais are seeing themselves as being very kind of developed in sort of the region, and most people will have attended school, whereas in Cambodia it's usually the case that a lot of people, particularly from very poor provinces, don't finish even elementary school, and so they have a very low level of skill. So in Thailand, someone the same age will probably have gone to high school at least and be able to get a better job that pays more. So Thais aren't that keen to work in, say, construction anymore because the wage they would command for it would be higher than a Cambodian would expect for the same amount of work. Okay. In Asia, the demand for highly skilled workers are usually met by male people, including many expatriates. If you think about Singapore, for example, a large number of people working in finance in Singapore are usually people from Australia or England to this day. On the other hand, for manual workers, the demand is usually for women. So if you think about people who are actually working in the Gap factories in Cambodia, they are usually women who often can't read or write, but they can, you know, handle running a machine. Intra-regional trading of women domestic workers is also very important, a lot from the Philippines and Indonesia. Women migrant workers were often found to engage in repeat or serial migration, particularly Filipino nannies and maids who often may have children back in the Philippines being cared for by their mother, by the children's grandmother, while the mother of the children goes and works as a maid for 3 years, comes back for 6 months, and then goes again for 3 years, because her working for 3 years outside of the country is enough to raise all of her children back in the Philippines. There are technology concerns as well. There are sort of, whenever people come in and think they're doing a good thing for a region by giving them, say, tractors, they will usually train only the men in how to drive the tractors. And there's no reason why women can't be trained to drive tractors, but often the donor agency has their own sort of ingrained perceptions of what is a suitable task for women and men in agriculture. And so those kind of perceptions from outside can often be imposed onto Southeast Asian communities in development as well, even though they may not have been there before. For example, in Cambodia, in agriculture, there are some jobs that women will only do, in threshing the rice, for example, that there are other jobs that only men will do, like climbing up a coconut tree to get the coconuts. Both of those things are viewed as equally important, they're just different. It doesn't mean one is considered to be more important than the other. Okay, and then we have gendered labor, which is the socially determined ideas and practices that define what roles and activities are appropriate for men and women. So, except for Malaysia and Singapore, most of the countries in Southeast Asia have economies that are based on agriculture, although tourism is very fast catching up. A large portion of the rural population in this region are women who are engaged in various types of agricultural work, planting crops, food processing, animal husbandry, inland fisheries, increasingly, and the marketing of agricultural products. So women farmers comprise a significant proportion of the total agricultural labor force, from 35% in the Philippines to over 60% in Thailand. Though their role in agriculture is vital for the well-being of families and society, women carry a triple burden in their everyday lives, as wives and mothers, as agricultural producers, and often as community workers. We often forget about this particular role. As daughters, women often have primary responsibility for the care of elderly parents and the rest of the family. There's a saying in many countries in mainland Southeast Asia that you have to pay your mother back for the price of your breast milk, so the milk she fed you as a baby. And for boys in Theravada Buddhist countries, it's easy to do this because boys can ordain as a monk. And I'm not sure how much people know about Buddhism here, but merit is kind of like a commodity you can transfer. So if you go and make a donation to a wat or a pagoda, you can say, I would like the merit of this action to be transferred to my mother's spirit, so that she then ups her merit bank and hopefully she gets reborn as a slightly better than she would have otherwise. In the past, people would go and make a donation to a wat in the name of the king. So the king's merit bank would be increased. So merit is not something that just happens to you. You can sort of shift it wherever you need it to go. So daughters, of course, cannot ordain as a monk. So if a boy wants to pay his mother back for the price of breast milk, he says, I would like the merit of my novitiate to be transferred to my mother. So she gets the merit from that action, and his debt to her for the breast milk is cancelled out. Girls can't ordain as monks. So instead, their burden is usually more economic in nature. They have to pay their parents back by taking care of them, or making sure that, you know, the mother has a house and in her old age enough to eat, medicine, etc. So care usually devolves more on daughters than boys. As wives and mothers, of course, women are expected to bear children, raise them, and take care of their husbands. As agricultural producers and marketers, women have to plant, weed, harvest, process, and sell the crops. As community workers, women often serve as ex officio health workers in villages a lot of the time. There'll be someone who knows sort of how to bring down a fever. There'll be women who are very good at helping other women give birth, even though they may not have had medical training, etc. And you know, if someone is in hard times, if a husband has died or a child has died, it's usually women who will go to that neighbor's house and comfort them and bring food and help them get back on their feet after something bad happens. So while the gender division of labor seems to be very natural a lot of the time, these ideas are, of course, socially constructed. There's no reason why men should not be doing some of the things that women are expected to do, including raising children and housework. And over the last 10 years in particular, I've seen a shift in the way people are thinking about these things. But some of them are very, very slow to go away. So agricultural policy makers have for decades turned a blind eye to farmers who are women because they think of farmers as men. So people like the World Bank, who give countries a lot of money to do development, the people in the World Bank earmarking money for development often think of farmers as men. because men are farmers where they come from, in France or in Switzerland or in the United States, not women. And so they shape policies for the money that's going to Myanmar or the Philippines in terms of, well, it'll be a male farmer receiving this money. So women often aren't eligible for things, they miss out on training schemes, and so the cycle starts all over again. This also impacts upon the ability of people to go to school and educate themselves. So this is a table of female literacy. So some countries are better than others, as you can see. Laos, strangely, is the worst, because I find that in socialist or communist countries, usually women have a higher degree of literacy, but this is not the case in Laos. We have to take Cambodia and Laos with a grain of salt because, as I said before, many people left. So highly educated people were not there when bad things happened. So this might be slightly skewed. But otherwise, if we look at the difference between female and male literacy, with 80% of Cambodian men being literate and 60% of Cambodian women being literate, this is a big, big gap. We can't blame it on, oh, well, there aren't enough schools, the Khmer Rouge just destroyed all of them, or there aren't enough teachers, because clearly one segment of the population is receiving more training in literacy than others. If we also look here at how many people go on to tertiary education, this is the percentage of total female population that go on to tertiary education. So Laos is actually better than Cambodia in this regard. Of the total female population, only 2% in Cambodia at the time this survey was done, a couple of years ago now, had actually finished a degree. I found this a little hard to believe because I often stay quite near the Royal University of Law and Economics in Phnom Penh, and there are lots of girls going in and out of the gate, so I don't know whether they don't finish their degree or what exactly is going on, or are they there to hang out and not actually go to school. But according to this survey done by UNICEF, only 2% of the total female population of Cambodia actually finishes a university degree, compared to places like Thailand, where 38% of the total population end up going on. Singapore, they didn't get any info for, and for some reason in Vietnam, we didn't get any information for secondary, but we do know that 9% of the total female population goes on to tertiary education. And Vietnam is a place where there is a great deal of rural agriculture going on, so that's a kind of high number for a country that has like 60% of its farming people are women. Okay, so this obviously is good in some countries, bad in others. I mean, it's good that in the Philippines, at least, 94% of girls finish primary school. That's a great figure. But this impacts upon the ability to participate politically. And you know the saying, decisions are made by those who show up. It's hard to make a decision if no one invites you to the place you're making the decision. So these educational rates of women impact upon their ability to get into positions where they can make changes for themselves. It's kind of dangerous to only have one gender represented in any decision making, because they simply don't think about things. So I remember in Australia when I was in university, one of the, we were bringing in basically a goods and services tax, so we didn't have one before about the year 1999. And so basically the government put together a panel to decide what things you bought at the supermarket would be considered a necessity and what would be considered a luxury good. So luxury goods were to have the goods and services tax, but necessities like milk and meat and fresh eggs and fresh vegetables were necessities, so they weren't going to be taxed. It was an all-male panel that decided what items were luxuries and what items were not. Where do you think they put feminine hygiene products? A luxury. They didn't consider them a necessity. They put them with things like razor blades and cotton wool pads. Then, when this came out, people were like, you don't think these things are a necessity. What do you want us to do? So this is an example of why it's kind of good to have a more balanced range of voices in any decision-making situation. So let's look here at political participation. In Singapore, women were able to vote from 1947 and stand as political candidates in the same year, but it took a long time for one to be elected to parliament. in 2001, obviously this is old data now, there were only, well, less than 6% of women in a ministerial position in Singapore. And Singapore is usually considered to be a very advanced nation in Southeast Asia. In fact, they're, I think, number 16 on the Human Development Index, above the United States, which is somewhere in the 30s. But they still have some very interesting attitudes towards women. In 2004, 16% of women had seats in the lower house. Well, 16% of all of the seats were occupied by women. Okay, in Malaysia, women have been able to vote since 1957, standards candidates since 1957. One was elected to parliament in 1959, and yet in 1990, between 1990 and 2004, only 10%, from 5 to 10% of seats were occupied by women. In Thailand, got the right to vote in 32, could stand as candidates in 32, took a while again for one to be elected to parliament, and then we have the same sort of low showing of total percentage rates. Laos, again, has surprising figures here. So right to vote in 58, right to stand in 58, and they elected women to parliament in 1958, which is great. At the ministerial level, over 10% in 2001, and over 22% in 2004. So for a socialist country, Laos is kind of going in the right direction. Brunei, the women's right to vote and to stand for election has not yet been recognized.
Wow.
Not that it would make a difference anyway, because they don't have a parliamentary system.
Right.
But there are still local elections for different things, like city council or town councils, decisions about environmental things, but the women cannot vote. They can drive in Brunei, at least, but they're not allowed to vote, assuming there is ever an election for anything. Okay, Cambodia and Vietnam. Vietnam has good showings, again, because of communism and socialism. There is this idea of bringing women in more. But it's still not fantastic. I mean, why isn't it 50%? So there are other things going on here. Partly it's to do with low levels of education for women that then precludes them from moving into positions of power. But there's also cultural constraints that are still at the back of people's minds when they think about women and power. Okay. So this is a quote I like to talk about quite a lot. Nationalist discourses espoused by Asian political leaders construct women as the repository of national traditional values, underscore Asian women's domesticity and asexuality, and ultimately privilege the male as the national subject. These are fighting words, right? There's a lot of statements being made here. What does it mean? Okay, so going back to what I was talking about in the previous talk about people rediscovering old ways of doing things from before the colonial period in an attempt to construct a national identity that had nothing to do with Europeans. So they needed to exert their autonomy culturally by the definition of their country, of their people, as separate from colonial powers. So this led to a redefinition of culture in the pre-colonial past as a golden age. Anything that happened before the Europeans came is considered a golden age. The way Cambodians really were, the way Burmese really were. I was about to say Thai, but of course the Thai have been colonized. So in this sort of rediscovery of themselves, indigenous literature was exalted. Traditional pre-colonial cultural characteristics were brought out and emphasized. And in this redefinition of culture, women were usually made the repository of values and attributes that were deemed to be traditional in the new cultural identity. So one of the ways we can see this still is in airline outfits that people have to wear. What's the difference between the men and the women in these pictures? The women are all wearing some kind of outfit that is traditional. Okay, so in the Singapore Airlines one, they're wearing batik, so traditional fabric, but they're also wearing the traditional outfit of a tight jacket and a long skirt. Same on Thai Airways. The women are wearing a long silk sampot, or skirt, and a tight silk jacket, and a lot of the time high heels, although I noticed the Singapore Airlines ones are not. It's very hard. I mean, if you've ever been on an airplane during turbulence, can you imagine wearing high heels, a really tight skirt and jacket that sort of constrains your movements, and you're trying to serve people drinks? Whereas the men in these pictures are wearing modern Western suits, that allow them freedom of movement. They're not wearing traditional clothing, and the reason is it's women who are always the ones who are meant to carry tradition with them. Men are allowed to step forward and be as modern as all get out, but women have to keep to traditional ways. And this manifests in a series of ways that are actually very bad for women. So for example, in Indonesia, New Order Indonesia from 66 to 98, New Order Indonesia wanted to establish equal rights for women within the framework of women's primary role as wife and mother. So their policies on women were legitimated by the ideology of Ibuism. Now, Ibu means mother, and it's also the honorific for a married woman, so I would be Ibu Jacobsen if someone was talking to me in Indonesia. So Ibuism basically sanctions any action, so women can do whatever they want, provided it is taken by the mother who looks after her family, a group, a class, a company, or the state, without demanding any power or prestige in return. So she should just do it, shut up, and not expect any gratitude, basically. And there are other similar ideologies in Southeast Asia. So in Burma, for example, the SLORC, the State Law and Order Reconciliation Council, their position in the 80s and 90s were that women are accorded equal rights with men. But there are some statistics that really refute this. Burma ranked 120 out of 163 for gender-related development a couple of years ago. I haven't read the most literacy one. Women's adult literacy rates for women were 11% lower than men. Women were earning 15% less income than men, ensuring they had a lower standard of women. And also, in a very powerful statement about where the Myanmar government saw women in the government, the Burmese delegation to the Beijing Fourth World Conference on Women had not a single woman in it. So in Burma, just giving you some context here, women constitute 51% of the total population. And despite this majority, there are no women in the ruling regime's cabinet until the election of Aung San Suu Kyi. The high political leadership of Burma until the last election was exclusively male. To the extent women are permitted to occupy prominent public positions, they are typically closely associated with the military. So for example, there's the Maternal and Child Welfare Association, but the women leading it are all the wives of prominent politicians. And Aung San Suu Kyi was the most respected Burmese person in the world. By all rights, she should be amongst the most powerful people in Burma. And yet, since she has been elected to a high position, she hasn't been able to do very much. And a lot of this has to do with the other politicians, male politicians she has to work with, not really seeing her as being particularly effective or having good ideas because of an ingrained perception about women. Women's movements, if they're organized by the state or the government, and also the initiatives that these organizations have, often espouse the policies of the government that are predicated on gender stereotypes and not real equality. So for example, in New Order Indonesia again, we have the Dharma Wanita, which is a civil servants' wives organization. We have the Family Welfare Movement, which still implements all government initiatives for women, but their only thing that they really want women to do is to fulfill the Pancha Dharma Wanita, or the five duties of women, which are to be a loyal supporter of one's husband, to effectively manage one's household, to produce the future generation, to educate and socialize one's children, and to be a good Indonesian citizen. So unless you're fulfilling all five of these things, you can't get assistance from the government, essentially. So the Pancha Dharma Wanita and things like the Chabatsrai in Cambodia are drawn from pre-colonial texts written by men who were stating what their ideal society would be, not a reflection of how the society they were living in actually was. And it's a really important distinction. Every single Southeast Asian country has pre-colonial literature in which men were writing, often men who were educated as monks or scholars, were writing about how they thought society should be, not the way it actually was. And so when in the nationalist exercise, people go and rediscover these texts, they're reading them thinking, oh, that's how society was. And there's no kind of critical thinking about it. Well, were things actually like that? So This phenomenon is something I've called the Golden Age syllogism, and it occurs frequently in Southeast Asia and ties in with what I was saying about the construct of new cultural identity with prescribed gender roles as a precursor to independence. These same classical texts, so there's a Chbat Broch, for example, the Code of Conduct for Men, there's a counterpart in Burma. These same texts say that men should not commit adultery or pay bribes or gamble or trade with the Chinese, I believe one of them is. But nobody is attempting to enshrine these same admonitions in state ideology. So again, it's the women who are expected to be traditional, not the men. The lack of women in high-level political positions is due to the imbalance of gender in education and because of gender stereotypes about women's position in society and their abilities. When asked why more girls are not attending schools, governments often say that it is because of tradition. But tradition doesn't actually stop people from going to school. It doesn't lie across the road and stop, you know, the bus from moving forward. Parents stop girls from going to school because of ingrained perceptions towards gender roles in their societies. If a family is poor, boys will be sent to school rather than girls. There's a belief in many places that boys are naturally smarter, that boys have a better chance of getting a job than a girl will, that boys can go on to further education in towns and cities far away, but girls cannot go because they have to stay at home and get married. Girls will just get married, so there's no need to waste money educating them. And this is one that I still hear about in Cambodia. If girls go to school, they'll be exposed to potential dangers of falling in love, thereby bringing shame to their family and then not being able to marry well. So there's obviously no biological evidence for any of these things. Perpetuating ideas of gender roles makes it easy for governments not to do anything. They just throw their hands in the air and say, well, it's traditional for boys to be more educated than girls. And to go out into the world to work, and for girls to stay home. Male domination is sustained by the social arrangements that provide them more opportunities. So unless someone breaks from doing this, things will not actually improve. Okay. I wanted to talk a little bit about gender-based violence, which is rife throughout Southeast Asia. Between 20 to 50% of all women in Southeast Asia will at some point be the victim of gender-based violence. According to most published studies on the subject, women in Southeast Asia are most often raped by a relative or a close friend of the family. We believe that 4 million women and girls are bought and sold around the world, and at least half of them are from Asia every year. Nearly 70 million women and children have been victims of sex trafficking in Southeast Asia in the last 10 years. So these are huge numbers, and they're growing every day. Now, there are a number of countries that have signed conventions that are meant to eliminate gender-based violence, and sex trafficking is a form of gender-based violence. So Cambodia, Indonesia, and the Philippines have signed the three instruments that are most important in bringing people to justice for doing these things. Malaysia has signed two of them, and Brunei, good old Brunei, always trailing behind, has only signed the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Children have more rights than women do in Brunei. Okay, so it's great to have these instruments signed, but unfortunately, a lot of the time, countries will just sign them so that they can tell donors, look, we've signed this convention, we're good now, give us more money. Without actually doing anything. So once you sign an international instrument, you then have to pass legislation at the national level to do something about it. And often that just never happens. Okay, so let's talk about sex tourism in Southeast Asia. The tourist industry has increased the demand for women, especially for young girls free of disease.